All right, so maybe we should begin now with the fourth session of air quality. The learning objective for this module for students is that the students will be able to qualify air pollutants. So one part is to quantify, but then they will also be able to qualify. It's one thing to say air is polluted and maybe read in the newspapers or look at the they've developed an air quality index which is now being used across the country. It will soon be implemented, which will tell you in some sense health of the air. So if it is green, means it's safe, maybe you can go out jogging, but if it's red, then you know it's probably a good idea to stay indoors. So there's a whole range, there's a scale that has been developed for air quality index. Now that's good for citizens, for people who might be affected, people who are not necessarily engaged with the dealing of air quality or aren't professionals in the area of air quality or aren't students and teachers in the area of air quality. But for people who are engaged in the area of air quality as teachers, students, professionals, it's not adequate to be able to say, okay, I just need to know whether air is breathable or not. You actually need to be able to qualify. Okay. So with that said, there are two kinds of pollutants in the air. This is quite obvious, but for students to be able to say that smoke is particulate matter, dust is particulate matter, but oxides of nitrogen or H2S is gaseous in nature. So we will spend a little bit of time in making a distinction between these, because the nature, the chemical engineering, the environmental engineering, the control engineering that's associated with these is very distinct. So when we say air pollutants, one of the first things we deal with is the concentration. And I think on one of the earlier lectures, we'd already talked about the concentration of sulfur dioxide. So it is typically mass of pollutant in a certain volume of air. Mass of pollutant, a particular pollutant in a certain volume of air. And when it comes to particles, you actually can do mass of particles or you can also do number of particles. And we'll get into the details of why the two could be different, and just sometimes the mass concentration is not adequate to be able to fully represent the impact of different kinds of particles. The third one, I've said opacity, and that's the third bullet is the reason why I have put concentration as in inverted commas. We talked about opacity yesterday. We talked about the grayscale. I'd even attempted to crack a joke about Fair and Lovely and how they have this skin gradation, skin scale. So we have similar grayscale going for all the way from white to black, and you put it against the smoke coming from a chimney, and based on that you'll be able to say how bad is the pollution. But you know, it's qualitative measure, it's not necessarily quantitative measure. Second aspect of the air pollutants is exposure, how many hours you are exposed, and both of these actually come into the standards, in the National Ambient Air Quality Standards. These come in, they come in both as concentration as well as exposure. So how much concentration were you exposed for how much time, whether it's detrimental for you or it's healthy to breathe. The next thing I introduce to the students then is criteria pollutants. Okay. And the way I relate with it is that when you go to the doctor, normally the doctor will look at your body temperature, would look at your pulse rate, and maybe put a stethoscope on your chest. Those are the two, three things that a doctor would do to figure out the general state of your health. Okay. So that, you know, is a good criteria for health, for a human body. So when we are looking at air quality, we don't want to get into the nitty gritty of every single molecule in the air, because that will get too tedious and it will get too difficult to kind of understand. It's not that it's not required, it's required, but when you get into diagnostics and we're trying to get into sources of the pollution, etc., etc., then you do have to do some very rigorous chemistry, okay? But for general purposes and as a general health of air, these are pollutants that are used to measure the criteria for quality, okay? So they are oxides of sulfur, oxides of nitrogen, carbon monoxide, PM10, I'll describe what PM10 means. It is basically particulate matter, particulate lead. These are all primary. Primary meaning that they are emitted directly from a source. And there's the secondary pollutant, which is ozone, which is not directly emitted, but is actually formed in the atmosphere. Now, just ozone, 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 ozone hole, ozone layer. A lot of times students have this confusion. So I usually tell them that ozone, which is above the troposphere, in the stratosphere, is good ozone. Thank God for that ozone, otherwise life as we know it on the planet would not exist. That is the ozone which actually developed a hole. That's the one which we are trying to fill up now by eliminating use of certain compounds. But this ozone is at our nose level. It's at the level of us as receptors. It is at the level of we being exposed to it. This is not good ozone. Okay, this is bad for health. So, but that's not really getting directly emitted from somewhere. It gets formed in the atmosphere through some atmospheric chemistry. So basically, we are left with that as a secondary pollutant. Primary pollutants are usually coming from some human activity, typically. Okay? So if you're living in a city, or if you're living in a village, if you're living in a small town, there is human activity, and we want to know how much of an influence the human activity is having on the quality of the air. So for example, any diesel, any coal that is burnt has sulfur. Okay? So the sulfur dioxide would come from the sulfur there. Oxides of nitrogen, because you're using air for combustion, and air has 78% nitrogen, that nitrogen at high temperatures would combine with oxygen to give oxides of nitrogen. So you got oxides of nitrogen coming from combustion also. Carbon monoxide, anytime there is combustion, there will be carbon dioxide, but then if it's incomplete combustion, there will be carbon monoxide. So carbon monoxide also is a result of combustion. PM10 is particulate matter, and particulate matter can come from various sources, and we will discuss that in great detail today. Particulate lead is associated with the leaded petrol that used to be used. It's not there so much now. And the ban or the elimination of the use of leaded petrol has eliminated this particulate lead. There's not much talk about it anymore. However, one of the things I always ask the students is, what did they do really? If they removed the lead, tetraethyl lead, what did they do? I mean, did the engine design suddenly become such that knocking is no more a problem? Or are we using a fuel which is doing the same job in the additive as lead was doing? And the answer is that some other additives are being used to have the same effect as tetraethyl lead. And there's still a question whether those are harmful, not harmful, and we should begin to monitor those, etc., etc. Okay? So engines are still knocking, and therefore the fuel does require anti-knocking agents. And instead of tetraethyl lead, they're using some other things, which is something which is right now we will not discuss in this particular course. Okay, so we are left then with criteria pollutants, primary and secondary. And these criteria pollutants are going to be used as an indicator of the health. So if there are standards for these, and these standards are met in a city, then you as a collector don't have to worry about the quality of the air in your city. However, if they are not met, then the whole investigative process begins as to where, which sources are contributing most to these pollutants or one of these pollutants, and how best to control these. Okay? I think today we will focus on PM10, which is the particulate matter. One of the things, you know, students usually don't know how these are measured, how is pollution measured. So I spent quite a bit of time on this particular flowchart. It's really straightforward. And the question to be answered is, how do you measure the mass concentration of particulate matter, PM, in the atmosphere? So you assume now that there is some polluted space, polluted area. It could be a room in which agarbattis are being burnt, or it could be outside near the traffic signal, or it could be near in a kitchen, or it could be near an industry, it could be in the desert area, it could be in some commercial area, doesn't matter. There's some space of air which is polluted, or we want to know how polluted it is. And so we have this arrow here really represents a small tube, plastic tube. Sometimes we can put a funnel at the end of it so that it collects from a larger area. But it's a tube which is suspended in that particular. So in this room, if I wanted to check the quality of air, I'll just take a tube and hang it somewhere and have that tube then come and connect up with this particular cartridge. Okay? And all this cartridge is there's a filter paper. It could be a glass fiber filter paper, cheaply available. And the cartridge is an assembly that you can unscrew and put this filter. Now, this filter is something that you have weighed already. Okay? And you have to be careful. Some of these filter papers have an affinity for moisture. So if it is a humid environment, then they will tend to absorb moisture. So you have to make sure that you have put it in a desiccator for 24 hours. And then you remove it, and you wait, and then you put it in this cartridge. And after you put it in the cartridge, you connect the second part of the outlet of the cartridge to a flow meter. So you want to know what is the volume that you're going to be sampling. And then you basically have a vacuum pump, a small vacuum pump, which could be driving this flow. So, you know, you run it, let's say, at 10 liters per minute for 10 minutes. So 10 liters per minute for 10 minutes would mean 100 liters. So you have sampled 100 liters of air in this room, or at a traffic junction, or in a kitchen, or, you know, wherever you want to sample. And then after 10 minutes, you stop. You actually remove this filter paper from here, and if the place is polluted, you'd probably see some deposit on it, okay? Some gray, brown, black, depending on where you are. In a kitchen, you'd probably see a lot of gray, black. In a traffic junction, you'll probably see a lot of black. In a desert area, you'll probably see a little light brown, light gray kind of a dust. So different places, different sources would have different kind of colors or gradations of colors. And so you take this sample, and again, a good idea, because there is moisture in the air and you have sampled a large volume through this filter, some of the moisture from the air that is passing through the filter would have gotten adsorbed onto the filter paper. So you don't want the filter paper to be affected, the mass of the particulate matter to be affected by this moisture. So you again put it in a desiccator for 24 hours, take it out, and the difference between the before and after is delta M, which is the mass. Okay, that's the total mass collected. Now, this total mass was collected in how much volume? The volume was 10 liters per minute, Q, for time 10 minutes. So, in 100 liters, how much mass? So, that would give you micrograms per meter cube. Okay? That is the way you would do it. I even encourage students to do this on their own. We have found a lot of times when you have set up a lab for them and they just come and do the measurements of, you know, time and flow rate, etc., it doesn't quite give them a hands-on experience. So a lot of times I actually just give them these as equipment that's available in the lab. You know, there'd be 4 or 5 pumps available, there'd be stopwatches available, there'd be these cartridges available. Just have to be careful with them sometimes that they don't, the weighing balance is a little sensitive. So usually we would not, if they have not, don't have training on a weighing balance, and I wouldn't let them touch the weighing balance. Because we use it for a lot of other M.Tech and Ph.D. research, so you don't want to damage it. But other than that, you know, this is like toys for them to play and get a hands-on experience. A lot of times, I even encourage them to damage equipment so that they can actually learn how to damage it, so next time they won't actually damage it. Okay, so that's what we do. This is now like, you know, some kind of building blocks like Lego or something that they can use. I'll stop at this for a moment, let you talk to each other, take a minute to just, you know, sort it out. If you have some questions, you can talk to each other and get it sorted out. So I'll stop for a minute, let you discuss what's on the display over there, and then I will come back. So here's a minute for you to discuss. Please go ahead and discuss. If you were to tell your students how to measure particulate matter in a polluted environment, how you would do it. Please go ahead, discuss now. Okay, all right. That, you know, what we just did in this previous method is we actually looked at the total mass, okay, total mass of the particulate matter, not really paying too much attention to the size. The only limitation of the size is something that can go through this tube, for sure. It'll be like a big boulder that has to go through this. You may not even find it in the air because it'll be so large that it'll probably have dropped by gravity to the ground, but small enough, particles small enough that are suspended over here that come through. And the only limitation is how much can this filter stop? Can it stop the smallest of particles? And how small is a question that we don't know. But assuming that, let's say this can capture all the, this is fictitious, it's an assumption, assuming that it can catch all the particles that are there and only allows gas molecules to go through, then in some sense, this method is only giving you the total particulate matter. Okay, total particulate matter. No size, just total. Okay, so when we look at that, and let's say now I put myself in a situation in which I do this same measurement in a village in a desert area on a stormy day versus in a busy urban junction, some kind of a traffic junction on a busy day, would they measure the same? The chances are that the measurement that is made in the desert village would be much higher than what you would measure in a busy urban traffic junction. Okay? So then, which is really bad? Is the desert dust bad, or is it the traffic emissions that are bad? That is something which we will not be able to say if we just take a look at the total particulate matter as a measure. So we cannot use total particulate matter because the health effect that a dust particle would have from sand in your nose or in your lungs would be very different the soot particle or the emissions particle that is coming from a diesel engine. Okay? So the health effects are different, and aesthetics is one thing, but we are really more concerned always about the health. What is the health effect of these pollutants? So we therefore need to look at, is there another dimension other than just the total mass concentration? Is there another aspect, is there another dimension we need to look at to be able to qualify it based on the health effect? Okay, so that's what we will talk about now. So, like all human beings are created equal is something we all know. I just want to say can't say the same about all particles. So, not all particles are created equal, and we will try and qualify this assertion. Oh, I don't know what you're seeing on your screen, but I think on my screen I'm seeing a small ant here, another small ant here, another small ant here, another small ant here, and another small ant here. Oh, many ants over here. Okay. And what is this? The color gray looks like that of an elephant, I think. But because I can't fit it on the screen, so probably it is an elephant. Maybe we are seeing only a part of the elephant. So this is like a little game I play with the students, and I usually do this on the board. So I'll just do some work on the writing pad now to share with you. This is a large class, okay? So what I do is I actually make a small dot on the blackboard and ask people if they're at the back of the room, whether they can see it. And it's small enough, they actually cannot see it. So I said, that's correct, because what I drew on the board is an ant. So just for the sake of argument, I'm going to make that as a bigger ant. Okay, so you can see this bigger ant here. Okay, you can see this big ant. And this big ant, if I were to look at a dimension of this big ant, what would be the dimension of this big ant? So invariably now, you know, people will start making a guess. And it turns out we agree upon that a small red ant is about 2 millimeters. Okay. Now on the same board, what I do is I draw an elephant. Okay. Now this is all to scale. I'm making it all to scale, and you already know that my drawing is very good. So now I'm going to draw an elephant. So this is the elephant. Can you see the elephant? That is the elephant. It's on scale. It's to scale. Sorry, I can't make the ant and the elephant on the same scale. So this is, you'll just have to, you know, extend your imagination and understand that this is an elephant. Okay. Now, what is the size of an elephant? I know, you know, most of us, we've been very productive people, and we have not used our time to go with a scale and measure ants and measure elephants. But just let's take a guess. Okay, just to make it easier, consider a spherical elephant. Okay, a baby spherical elephant. Okay. So I think a baby spherical elephant would be about 6 feet across. Is that a good idea? 6 feet is okay? Everybody agree? 6 feet? Okay, 6 feet. So about 6 feet, which is about 2 meters. Okay, so which means that we are talking about 10 to the power of 3. Okay, so the scale is 10 to the power of 3. Why is that important? Why are we doing this? We're really doing it because what I want to highlight to the students is that when we are dealing with gaseous pollutants, when you're dealing with gaseous pollutants, when you're dealing with carbon monoxide, when we're dealing with oxides of sulfur, when we're dealing with oxides of nitrogen, hydrocarbon molecules, etc., we're dealing with ants. We're dealing with ants. And when we are looking at particulate matter, when you're looking at smoke and dust, we're actually dealing with elephants. So these are elephants. When you see dust because it has a certain size and it scatters light. But around each of this dust particle, there will be lots and lots and lots of ants or gas molecules. So these are elephants suspended in an ocean of gaseous ants, so to say. Okay? So the order of magnitude is 3. The order of magnitude is 3. So you cannot deal with particulate matter, the physics of the particulate matter, the same way as we deal with gases. Gases we explain quite well. Kinetic theory of gases we understand very well, and students have been doing it. It's a part of their DNA to actually, you know, P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2. They know all of that. That's gases as we've known it. The ideal gas, we've known it since class 8th. But particulate matter as elephants now suspended in that gas is something which is not so well understood. So that appreciation needs to come in, and that's what, you know, I use as an indicator of what they would be. So now I even ask them to imagine themselves to be zoomed to the size of a gas molecule. So when they are zoomed to the size of a gas molecule, like in a science fiction movie, and they see a particle of dust from sand coming from Thar desert, then they're actually seeing, oh, this is like a elephant coming, or this is like, you know, a dinosaur coming. Okay. So when they begin to see that, they actually say, okay, they can actually distinguish why we have to deal with gaseous pollutants distinctly from particulate pollutants. Okay, so that's ants over here, and that's an elephant, and sometimes even dinosaurs. Okay, so we will talk about that. So I hope this is clear, that when we're dealing with particles suspended in air as pollutants or as dust or as sand, we are really dealing with elephants and sometimes dinosaurs, an ocean of ants. Okay, so just to get the scales right, an ant is about 2 millimeters, a spherical baby elephant about 2 meters, the order of magnitude is 3, factor of order of magnitude is 3, nitrogen molecule is about that much, respirable particle is about that much, order of magnitude is the same. Okay? So it's, I spend quite a bit of time on this to emphasize to the students that distinction. Okay. Now, all the well-established physics of ants, ideal gas, is not applicable to the elephants. All the magic of nano is in this new world of elephants. All the nanotechnology, nanoparticles, nano this, nano that, it's all in that domain. Now, the ability to understand this range of sizes has become possible during the development of instrumentation in the last 30, 40 years. Okay? So, if you looked at some of the chemical engineering handbooks or mechanical engineering handbooks or civil engineering handbooks, by and large, they would stop when they, anytime they're talking about particle analysis, they'd probably stop at 2 micrometers or so, sometimes 1 micrometer, but by and large 2 micrometers. This was still about 20 years ago. Okay? So when I was doing college, my handbook, I still have a copy of my handbook from that edition. It doesn't go, the scale for particulate matter does not go less than 2 micrometers. So it's almost like anything which is smaller than 2 micrometers used to be dealt with. Now this is too small to handle, and therefore it needs to be handled as a gas. Okay? That's not the case anymore. We're talking about elephants which are still in suspense. That dimension, that scale of size is in not really gas molecules, not really large particles, but somewhere in between. So the last 3 decades has been exciting times for aerosol science and engineering. So when we're dealing with particulate matter in atmosphere or synthesis, We're dealing with aerosol science and engineering, and there are many aspects of it. So powder production, material sciences, nanoproducts, atmospheric pollutants, medical sciences, you know. So we'll talk about that in a little bit, but there's been a lot of application of nanoparticles because we have a better understanding of how to make these particles, how to transport these particles within the human body. Okay, so now this is really to give students a sense of the relative sizes of particles, okay. So let's start at the bottom. This is visible to the naked eye, and if I were to add something over here, I would probably add human hair. So human hair is about 100 micrometers. So the way you see it is that if you take 10 hair and put them all one next to each other on a centimeter scale, then they will cover 1 millimeter. So 100 micrometer hair would fit on a 1 millimeter, you know, 1 millimeter gradation on a scale. I usually, you know, do this in the class, and of course then I have to caution the students not to pull each other's hair to do that experiment. But that's a way of being able to communicate to them that's the size. So hair is visible, 100 micrometers is visible. People by and large have also used optical microscope. And in an optical microscope, they have looked at blood cells, they have looked at other cells, bacteria for example. So bacteria, blood cells, they are in the size range of 1 to 10 micrometers. An optical microscope has a limit of about half a micrometer, because if you're using the optical wave band, the wavelength that you're using is of the order of half a micrometer. So anything smaller than half a micrometer, then you cannot resolve with that wavelength. So the limit of the optical microscope is about half a micrometer. Half a micrometer is still an elephant for us, okay, talking about elephants. Half a micrometer is still an elephant for us. So we actually then have to, if you want to understand these particles which are elephant-like in atmosphere, then we need to go to electron microscopy, or now there are some other methods. In one of the lectures I will devote on how to measure these. So electron microscopy is also available. This is the range where we will normally be operating for looking at the elephants. Now let's look at some of the other sizes also. This is bacteria here. This is dust, fumes, okay, fumes. This is fumes coming from smoke, coming from welding, for example, welding, arc welding operations, etc. This is smoke coming from oil. It could be different kinds of oil that are being burnt, kerosene oil, other oil that is being burnt. Viruses are here. Viruses cannot be seen by an optical microscope. They're too small to be seen by an optical microscope. And oh, gas molecules are here. Ants are here and elephants are here. Okay, ants are here and elephants are here. But the three orders of magnitude, the same three orders of magnitude applies over here. Okay, anything else that's interesting? Tobacco smoke. Okay, now we'll talk about, I'm so excited about tobacco smoke, I'll tell you why. Okay. But before I go into that excitement, I will actually tell you why we are interested in these sizes from the perspective of breathability. What is respirable? What is not respirable? So I put a sign, by the way, this red line over here, I think, I'm not too sure, but I think it represents the wavelength of light. So in some sense, it is the limit of the optical microscope. I drew this red line over here. By the way, that's the URL for this website. What is respirable? So the human nose is designed a particular way, and including the hair inside the nose, okay? It's designed a particular way, and it actually does a very good job of removing particles larger than a certain size, okay? So for a normal adult human nose, 10 micrometers is the size which gets stopped in the nose, okay? 10 micrometers, the size 10 micrometers. So anything which is larger than 10 micrometers, you can expect that it will get stopped in the nostrils. Anything smaller than 10 micrometers is considered respirable, okay? So when we say PM10, particulate matter 10, 10 is an indicator of the size. So 10 micrometers, 10 really represents 10 micrometers. So anything smaller than 10 micrometers is respirable. Now, at this point in time, again, I do some very disgusting things in the classroom. So I'm going to go ahead and share with you what I do in my classroom. Okay, ready? Okay, so what I do is I tell students to do an experiment. Okay, they're not supposed to do this in the class. When they go home in the privacy of their room, they're supposed to do this. So you take this finger, and not that you don't do it already, okay? You do it all the time. It's just that you just make sure nobody's watching, okay? So I'm here on public display now. So what, you know, you do is you take this finger and you put it in your nose. And you turn it over there and something comes out. Some disgusting looking thing comes out, right? Okay. Now that disgusting looking thing, if you're in a clean environment, happy, it would probably look like a light green color, like that of cement color, okay? Oh, most of you have not seen it because you actually do it in the dark or something like that. And you know, you kind of look, nobody's seeing, and then you, you know, sometimes you, it's disgusting where you actually go and wipe your finger after that, okay? But usually keep a handkerchief, okay, when you're doing this experiment. It's a part of the material setup that you require, a handkerchief and a finger, okay, that's what you need. So, you know, you look at that, you should really see it, okay? You should see it, observe it, maybe even get a lens and see, you know, what's going on over there. And that's a part of the system. By the way, doctors would do it, okay? Any lab, pathology lab would do this. That's a part of the work that they do. It's not disgusting for them. It's actually their bread and butter. They actually do a lot of scientific analysis through that, okay? So you take a look at that and you say, okay, this is what it looks like. And then on another day, if you've gone out to the city sometime, you've gone in a dusty area, you've gone in a polluted area, et cetera, you come back and you do another experiment. This time, of course, with a clean finger again, you do that. And you observe, and sometimes you do selfies. You know, most of us so love doing selfies these days. So instead of doing a selfie of your face, do a selfie of your finger, okay? And look to see if this color was any darker than the light green cement color that you had actually seen earlier, okay? Why I'm doing this, and this is something which students go, and you know, they're very embarrassed by this adult over here. But it's important for us to be able to kind of appreciate the function that the nose does, okay? And not so much for this class, but for one of the M.Tech classes, I do the same work. But we actually get into the details of calculating, is really 10 micrometer the size that will get stuck in nose by virtue of the fluid dynamics, okay? If a particle is moving at a certain breathing rate, okay, you're breathing at a certain rate, and air is going in, and the particles are suspended, these elephants are suspended in that, in this ocean of ants called gas molecules. They're coming into your nose, and they actually are now experiencing an obstacle called the hair in the nose, okay? That hair in the nose, that elephant will be coming, and the ants will be coming. So will that elephant bypass that particular hair, or will it actually go and impact it, okay? So they actually go and do a calculation for that and figure out whether the 10 micrometer is actually the correct number or not. But that's way beyond the scope of this particular class. But you know, I even give them an assignment in which say, you know, what would be the respirable particle size for an elephant? Now, elephant has a long trunk, right? So, you know, there's a certain rate at which the elephant breathes. So I don't know what is respirable for me is the same which is respirable for an elephant. Never mind that a baby's breathing rate and the baby's nostril size, whether the respirable is PM10 or not, okay? That's something that we have to deal with, even if we don't have to deal with the elephant trunks, okay? Enough said, I think, about this. Are you all convinced that nose does a good job? Yes? Yes? Okay, very good. All right, so this is stopped in the nose, okay? Anything which is greater than 10 micrometers, this is 10 micrometers, gets stopped in the nose. So, why I was excited about tobacco smoke is that when you smoke, I'm not promoting it, I'm not saying you should, but when people smoke, and they shouldn't, not good for health, but when they smoke, the smoke actually is respirable. If it is not respirable, they'd be wasting money on the cigarettes. Okay? So, it's respirable. Now, the physics of tobacco smoke, when we go back to some of our traditional medicine systems, there are still places where, of course, there's abuse of drugs, but then there are places where they would actually have like a hookah or a chillum in which they put a little bit of medication, and that medication actually gets inhaled and gets to the lungs and actually has people be well. And I'm pointing to it also from the perspective of that there's abuse to it, so drug abuse. But the point, the physics is not very different. So let's just extend it a little more. I'm sure you have people, or some of you actually deal with this, that you carry a little can for people who have asthmatic issues. They carry a little spray can, which from time to time you actually go and do, okay? You take that, you put that in your mouth and you do that spray. Now, whether that droplet will actually get to your lungs or not, the physics of the respirability is still the same. What size of that particular droplet should be there such that it actually gets to your lung? Because once it gets to your lungs, once it gets to the alveolus, that's where it is effective. If it gets stuck somewhere in the throat, and a lot of times 70-80% of it gets stuck in the throat, only 20% has some chance of being able to go through, you suddenly therefore have an interest in what is the size distribution of the spray that comes out from that aerosol can. But what I'm pointing to is that the physics, okay, physics, the understanding of physics, when we said medical delivery, you know, medical applications, the same physics is applicable over there, okay? I say another thing which is not in this particular slide, I also talk about materials, okay? For example, paint pigment. Paint pigment, there is a particular brand which has got two kinds of paints. One is white, deluxe white they call it, and one is super deluxe white. The super deluxe white is 10 times more expensive than the deluxe white. How come? Both are white. No, but there's a difference. The difference is that the deluxe white is just white pigment, whereas deluxe, super deluxe white has pigment which has a very narrow size range. And that narrow size range is selected in such a way that it scatters maximum amount of light. So if you use just 1/20th of that paint, it will scatter as much light as one unit of the deluxe white paint, okay? So the amount of paint that you need is 20 times lesser, okay? So the whole aspect of what application can you use the size and their function and the interaction with light, interaction with the body, interaction with blood cells, interaction with, you know, magnetic fields, interaction with your nose, all of those, the entire range is available in this domain of elephants suspended in ants, okay? So here's the website, here's the URL for that, please go ahead and see it. Okay, now relative sizes, I think we've talked about this already. Again, one more time, paint pigments. This is where if your paint pigment was within size, it will scatter maximum amount of light. Viruses are in this size range, respirable for sure. Tobacco smoke, we just discussed, is also, and I also said delivery. Delivery meaning from the perspective of medication, okay? Here's another, I should put a URL for that, but this is again one of those free to use images. This is a very complicated figure, okay? So I'll spend a little bit of time on it. I spend a lot of time on this with my students. So I would appreciate you getting behind this and understanding it in a way that actually then students would be able to appreciate it from you. So the x-axis is the diameter of the particles, okay? This is 10 micrometers, so everything here is respirable. Everything on this graph is respirable. This over here is some kind of a concentration, and I say some kind of a concentration because there are two types of graphs over here. One is the mass, and the other is number, okay? So this axis is representing both mass and number, but it's normalized. So when you go ahead and look at the particles in the atmosphere, there are three distinct modes. Normally when we deal with Gaussian distributions, we deal with unimodal, single mode, one mode, okay? But what's been observed across the world is that the atmospheric, the ambient aerosols, ambient particulate matter, have three modes. The first one is called the coarse mode. These are particles which are large particles, which are huge elephants, dinosaurs, okay? And they stay in the atmosphere for some time, but by and large, they'll settle out because they're large enough, gravitational settling will be effective and they'll tend to settle out. They're usually benign. They come from crustal material, geological material. They're not coming from any reactions. They're not coming from any chemicals. These are just geological dust material. So even if you were to breathe it, it is inert. So it will not have much of a health effect. Much of it will get stuck either a little past the nose or, you know, upper part of the trachea. Then there is this other mode on this side, which is called the nuclei mode or the nucleation mode, okay? Nucleation mode is something which is coming from, I don't know how to say this, but this is where the particles are born. That's probably the best way I can say it. These particles have existed for centuries, okay, for thousands of years. They just happen to be on the ground, happen to get re-entrained with the movement, with either wind or traffic, etc., etc. So these are dust materials, inert material. They've been around for thousands of years. Whereas these particles over here, the nuclei mode, are particles that are just born. Okay? Let me explain when I say they're just born. So when we were kids, you know, we used to, I used to live in Dehradun. I grew up in Dehradun. And winter time, it really used to get cold. So I don't know, you know, for some of you who live in colder cities, during December sometime, January sometime, we used to pretend like we were smoking, okay? So we would take a fake cigarette, fictitious cigarette like that, and do this, and actually smoke would come out of our mouth, okay? So what is this smoke, really? It's not very different, probably, from the smoke that comes out from a chimney. The white smoke that you see coming out from a chimney is similar smoke, okay? And that is what? That's basically water droplets. So inside the mouth, at 37 degrees Celsius, the air is 100% humid, you know, just very, if not 100% maximum, you know, it's like 95% humid. You should sometime do that, actually. So one experiment was to test what's going on in your nose. You and I have always put a thermometer in our mouth to see what the temperature of the body is. Maybe you should also get a humidity meter, a relative humidity probe, and see what is the humidity in your mouth. Just check it out. Probably close to 100%. So when this fully humid, 100% humid comes out of the mouth, it suddenly experiences a cold environment. And in some sense, the vapor molecules get together and form droplets. Okay? So till it was in the mouth, if I opened the mouth and I showed it to somebody, you would not see the smoke. All you would see is my tongue and my teeth and, you know, a part of my throat. But you would not see the smoke. But when I do like that, smoke comes out. So actually, smoke didn't come out. What came out was the water vapor, which under these cold conditions, nucleated. Nucleated, okay, not condensed. Nucleated, distinct from condensation. So if I were to take two bottles of water, and one had normal room temperature water, and the other one had cold water, okay? Even from far, you'd be able to tell me that this one has cold water. Why? Because there would be some condensation outside it, okay? That is condensation as we know it, okay? Nucleation is not the same as condensation. It is distinct from it because it does not require a surface. It's called homogeneous nucleation. So the physics is something that is a little complicated, so we won't get into the details of that. But you should just know that that is the birth of a particle. For the first time, many ants of a particular kind, many ants, which are water molecules, got together at some point in time and formed this, the start of a baby elephant. Okay? So that's the birth of a particle. That's the birth of a droplet. Okay? So that's what nucleation is. That's one way of particles being formed. Another way of particles being formed is from chemical reactions. So for example, if you are burning a candle, you can actually see that at the top of the flame, there are these carbon particles that are emerge. emerging. Okay, if you take a candle with the flame over here and you put this paper, white paper, just above it, not close enough, otherwise it will burn the paper, just far enough, you'll actually get deposit of these carbon particles. Where did these particles come from? They came from some chemical reactions that took place within the flame. The wax melted, it went through that wick, and after that wick, it burnt in that flame, and after the flame, whatever was unburnt actually came out, or some reactions that took place that gave rise to that soot. You can see it in an agarbatti. You take an agarbatti and you light it. As long as the yellow flame is there, you will see some black smoke coming out of it. Okay? That is birth of particles. That is formation of particles. If you then take the agarbatti and you remove the yellow flame, you extinguish it, you do psh, and it goes off. And then instead of black smoke and a flame, you start seeing white smoke or gray smoke coming out of it. Now that gray smoke, in terms of the chemistry, is very different from the black smoke which is coming out from a candle or which is coming out from an agarbatti, and which is very different from the chemistry of the smoke that came out of my mouth when I was a child and I was trying to pretend that I was smoking. Okay? So the whole aspect of what size of the particle, what chemistry of the particle is something which is going to be of interest to us, because that chemistry and that size is going to decide how detrimental it's going to be for my health. Okay? So this is the nucleation mode then. Very small size, sometimes so small that it actually behaves like a gas almost. So if I take this room, put a little bit of perfume over there, somebody at the other end of the room will be able to smell it very quickly. Ah, nice smell. Okay. Same thing with an agarbatti. If I light an agarbatti in that corner and I have somebody say, and they'll say, yeah, I can smell it. So it's almost like these particles are small enough that they behave in terms of the transport. They behave almost like ants, or they behave like gas molecules. So a lot of times in the atmosphere, they will disappear very quickly. They will not accumulate in one particular place. But some of these particles also tend to coagulate, and I'll go into the next details of it in the next slide or so. These particles collide with each other and become bigger, and some of these particles are particles now, and they provide a surface on which now, instead of nucleation, condensation can take place. So these particles are now getting bigger. Now these particles, when they get bigger, they stop behaving like gases. They cannot dissipate so quickly like gases, so they begin to now accumulate in the atmosphere. So this mode over here, the third mode, is referred to as the accumulation mode. It is the mode which will be in the atmosphere for the longest time. Okay? So this slide shows you that particle diameter. This is the particle diameter, and this is the collection or removal efficiency from the atmosphere. Particles which are larger than 1 micrometer, they are large enough that gravity would act on them, and the sedimentation rates are high enough that they will be taken away by gravitation. Okay? These particles over here on this side, which are much smaller, the smaller they are, the more they act like a gaseous molecule, and they tend to diffuse out. So these are particles which are large enough that gravity will do the work. These are particles which would be small enough that it will act like gases and diffuse out. Somewhere in between these two sizes, there is a particular size which is neither small enough to diffuse out like a gas, nor large enough to sediment out like a large particle. Okay? Somewhere near 1 micrometer is the size which will stay in the atmosphere for the longest time. So if you really take this over here and you flip it horizontally, you actually see this particular mode. Okay? So this mode over here is somewhere near 1 micrometer. These particles are small enough that they will diffuse out. These particles over here, anything larger over here, is large enough that they will sediment out. But somewhere in this range are particles that are neither small enough to diffuse out nor large enough to sediment out. So they tend to accumulate in the atmosphere. And that is, these are particles which you and I tend to get exposed to maximum, because they are in the air for the longest time. These will disappear, but these will remain for the longest time. Okay? So that is a very critical aspect of size and the three modes that students need to get, because that's at the heart of most of the research that we've been doing in the area of air quality. Okay? Now I'll switch my attention to the pink plot. Okay? So this was the dashed blue plot that we talked about. I'm now going to talk about the pink plot. pink plot is not mass, it is the number of particles. Okay, it is the number of particles. So, if I were to take a 10 micrometer particle and there is a certain mass that this 10 micrometer particle would have, and I take a small 1 micrometer particle and this has certain mass, if I were to make these equal, I would have to take some number of particles to be able to balance the two masses. Okay? So, that number over here is 1000, because the dimension is 10 times, the size is 10 times, in terms of the volume it is dp cube. So, 10 multiplied by 10 multiplied by 10, which is 1000. So, the point is that a 10 micrometer particle is equal in mass to 1000 1 micrometer particles. Okay? So, 10 micrometer particles is 1000 times as heavy as a 1 micrometer particle. So, while the dimension, the linear dimension increases by one order, the mass dimension increases by 3 orders of magnitude. Okay? So, the smaller particles therefore don't contribute much to the mass. They may be very high in number, but they don't contribute much to the mass. So, this pink line over here is the number. So, while the number concentration is extremely high, the number of particles that in my fake smoking or from a candle or from an agarbatti, the number of particles is very high, but the contribution to the mass is very small because of this dp cube relationship. Okay? Over here, the particle number is small, but the mass is quite high because of the 1000 factor. Okay? And over here, in fact, the pink disappears almost completely. There may be very few particles which contribute. So, you know, if you were to do, this is where the debate is right now. The debate is, should we have mass-based measurements for standards or should we have number-based measurements? Because if you remove a 100 micrometer particle, 100 micrometer particle, it is equivalent of removing in mass 1 million 1 micrometer particles. So, you know, it's like, oh, so what I'm saying is that I can get rid of one large particle and that will compensate for a million small particles. You can't compare the two because the size that we are dealing with, the breathable size that we are dealing with, the numbers are very high. There's another aspect. It's not just the number is high, the surface area of course will also be high, but the source of these particles, okay, they're coming from some chemical reaction, they're coming from some human activity, they're coming from some combustion source, they're coming from some combustion which is incomplete. So, all the reactions that would take place in a combustion domain, all of those, the incomplete combustions lead to these many byproducts which are not necessarily complete in their reactions. So, they are not stable. They will tend to get into your lungs and then just go ahead and actively start participating in the reactions. So, we got two things to deal with. One, the size is such that it is respirable. The size is such that it is large in numbers in surface area. And the size is such that the chemistry of it is coming from chemical reactions. So, we are in a situation where this particular window over here is the most dangerous and the least understood in a lot of ways also. Okay? So, that's what this particular pink plot is about. Okay. Now, these are several pathways that particles from one mode can move to the next mode. So, I mentioned to you about coagulation and condensation. So, this is just a description of that. This over here was what's happening in the atmosphere. The particles are already there, vapor is already there, ants are there, elephants are there. Ants will go and sit on elephants, so that's condensation. Elephant will combine with each other and bigger elephants. Okay, so all that is going on. It's a dynamic process. In fact, the entire process we deal with as aerosol dynamics. lot of the atmospheric chemistry, a lot of particle formation in the atmosphere that happens, which leads to secondary aerosols. So all that is there beyond the scope of this particular course, but that's happening, and you know, that's being researched upon, and that's well documented. Then this one is slightly different. It is different. It is saying what happens during combustion. And this particular case, they're saying, let's say if you were to burn coal. So when you begin to heat up the coal, a lot of the volatiles from the coal will actually volatilize. They'll evaporate. Okay? And then some of the char will burn, and some of the metals, heavy metals that are available in the char at that temperature will volatilize. So now what you have in the vapor phase may be some hydrocarbons, some metal vapor, and some other compounds. And then the coal will burn out, and some of the mineral material, fly ash for example, what is referred to typically the ash, will come out as bottoms, which are large particles. But these small particles, small vapor, the vapor and the gas, etc., they tend to react, or they tend to nucleate out into smaller particles, which are very difficult to control, even in the best available control options. And these tend to then get emitted from the chimney. Okay? So if you look at the chemistry of particles which are coming from here and particles which are coming in the chimney, these particles will be rich in SiO2, okay? Basically ash. Whereas these particles, the smaller particles, are preferentially enriched in heavy metals. So what is being emitted is actually something which is enriched in heavy metals, which is not good for health. Okay? So then again the whole issue comes up. Are you going to do mass-based measurements, or are you going to do number-based measurements? That issue comes up. So this is something which is hot research, which has been going on for the longest time. Mercury is an issue over here. A lot of times people want to know. Mercury, again, it's liquid at room temperature. It volatilizes. And, you know, so it's very trace quantities, sometimes even not even measured by, you know, we recently did some XRF. We couldn't catch mercury. So for mercury, you have to go for another method, which can go to parts per billion level rather than parts per million level, etc. So those are some of the concerns from a chemistry perspective. Okay, now we said not all particles are created equal. We said, you know, that these particles have different chemistry, they get formed differently, they have different sources. But we have another aspect to look at, and which is how many of these particles will actually go through the nose. But once they go through the nose, what happens to them? Where will they deposit? In the lungs or in the alveolus? So this again is a little complicated graph, and I think if you're not seeing it clearly, it's because the image itself is not clear over here. But you know, you should really focus on this particular solid blue plot, which is the deposition. Okay? And this is the deposition inside the lungs. And these are our three modes that we had talked about. First mode, this is the coarse mode, this is the accumulation mode, and this is the nucleation mode, the nuclei mode. And if you notice that the maximum deposition is happening in this particular size range. So this is how you may want to look at it, that when we breathe, anything which is greater than 10 micrometers will get stuck in the nose, but anything less than 10 micrometers will get inhaled all the way into the alveoli, which is the last part of the balloon in the lungs. I remember from my class 11-12 biology that we had to draw, you know, the lung, the detail of the lung, and there was this little balloon or a collection of balloons, and around the balloons there would be a capillary or many capillaries. And the different thing about this particular capillary was that it was, the arteries were bringing in blue blood, which was deoxygenated blood, and the veins were carrying blood which was enriched in oxygen, which was red in color. This is opposite to all the other parts of the body where you, the arteries are bringing in oxygenated blood and taking away the deoxygenated blood. Okay, so that detail of that alveolus is, you know, kind of etched in my memory, and that alveolus is where, you know, the air tends to stay for a certain fraction of a second before it is exhaled out. So there's a lot of physics that goes into the understanding, a lot of modeling that goes into the understanding of what are these particles, what is the size, and where, in which parts of the lungs they might deposit. So you breathe in, and then you breathe out. So for example, if you see somebody smoking, they breathe in the smoke and then they exhale, you know, much of the smoke comes out. Okay. So similarly, when we breathe in particulate in the pollutants in the air, you breathe in, you can't see them because the concentrations are fairly low, but you breathe them in and then most of them you breathe out, but there's a certain fraction over there, that has a good 70 to 80% chance that it will deposit in your lungs, and that is in this particular size range. Okay, see this over here, it's about 70%. 70% of these particles have a good chance that they will deposit out. Okay, so that's the size dependence of where the particles will deposit within the lung or different parts of the lungs. Similarly, this is now, they break it up. They break it up in terms of the beginning of the, you know, in the head, then they talk about the bronchioles, then the alveoli, different parts, and this is the total, okay? This is the total, and somewhere here is the highest deposition, okay? And different physics models would give you different results, but predominantly everybody's agreeing that somewhere in this size range, the deposition in the alveoli is highest, okay? So again, the URL is given and you're more than welcome to look at it. Okay, now I'm going to share some slides from the PhD work of one of my students. His name is Dr. Nitin Goel. He completed some 7-8 years ago. These are still relevant, so I'm going to share some of these slides. He went and did some measurements of size distributions in two places in Mumbai. Okay, these are the two places in Mumbai. One was in the Worli area, which is near, in Mumbai you can't be too far away from the ocean at any point in time. But this is about maybe about a kilometer away from the ocean. This would be about maybe another 5-6 kilometers away from the ocean. Okay, so these are two places where we did measurements. These are the size distributions. These were done at different times of the day. This gray one over here, the last one over here, is the 24-hour average. This is PM10, by the way. The blue line is PM10. So everything on the left-hand side, the way this is plotted is that if you were to take area under this curve, okay, so if you take this line over here and you take area under any of these curves, it will give you the total mass concentration. Total mass concentration of particulate less than 10 micrometers. So different times of the day, the size distributions change, which is likely because there are different sources. At daytime, you'd have all the vehicle movement. Nighttime, you don't have any vehicle movement. So you're expecting that the size distributions will be different because the sources are different at different times of the day. I've also put over here a red line, which is PM2.5. Okay? As PM10 is 10 means less than 10 micrometers, PM2.5 means less than 2.5 micrometers. Okay? That's pretty straightforward. And we started with PM10. But then realize that a large part of the mass contribution to PM10 may be coming from the coarse mode. So, you know, large part of the mass contribution may be coming from the coarse mode, but the particles which are generated by human activity are not necessarily in the coarse mode, that they are in a mode which probably falls under 2.5 micrometers. So we now have made yet another classification. PM10 is fine, but then there is a subset of PM10 which is more associated with anthropogenic activity or human activity. So if you want to really be able to measure human activity, you want to be able to take PM10 as well as PM2.5 to see how much contribution is coming from coarse mode and how much is coming from human activity. Okay? So PM2.5 got introduced at some point in time, and we've been very commonly now using the ratio of PM2.5 to PM10, okay? PM2.5 to PM10, the ratio, it's an indicator of anthropogenic to combustion activities or human activities. So the smaller the ratio, that means human activity is contributing less. Larger the ratio, that means more and more of particulate matter in the atmosphere is coming from human activity, okay? Ratio is large. Most of the particles will reach lungs and they are possibly more toxic. So PM2.5 to PM10 ratio being large is not a good idea. So you're qualifying PM10 even further. You're not just saying PM10 as a total mass concentration of particles smaller than 10 micrometers. You're also saying within that mass concentration, how much of it is coming from human activity, how much of it is likely to be toxic. Okay? Now these are some measurements that we had made in Pune and in Mumbai, and this is PM10 over here on the x-axis. On the y-axis is PM2.5. okay, and this is the slope. So slope is actually the ratio, okay, the slope gives the ratio, and the ratio is 0.58, 0.51, which is typical in India. This is for Mumbai, this is for Pune, not very different. We thought Pune being an inland city, it may be very different. It's not very different. Again, ranges around 0.5 or so. Okay. Then we put all of these together. This is Mumbai, Pune, everything together. This over here is measurements made during Diwali. We expected that during Diwali time, that because a lot of firecrackers are being burnt, a lot of combustion is happening, so the chances of smaller particles would be higher. But you know, it somehow seems to fall on the same line as the rest of the graphs. That's probably because there's a lot of traffic movement too. A lot of dust is also in the air. But if we did just take this particular set and do the PM10 to PM2.5 ratio, the PM2.5 to PM10 ratio is actually greater than the rest of the average. Now, just one last thing. I'll show you this little box over here. This box. This box is showing that this box is basically the CPCB standards for compliance. So as long as you are inside this box for PM10 and PM2.5, you're in compliance. So the bad news is that most of the time in Pune, in Mumbai, we are outside the box. Now I know out of the box is considered to be good and all that stuff in, you know, creative thinking, but here when we're taking out of the box, it's not a good thing. It's saying most of the time we're not in compliance, okay? All right. So again, this is just to reinforce that PM2.5 to PM10, if the ratio is less, then it's a good thing. If the ratio is high, then the pollutants are toxic. Okay, I'll stop here. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.